is Dr. Pola Rosen, the publisher of Education Update. And it's a pleasure to be here today in Brooklyn with President Karen Gould, who is the first woman president in a 79-year history of Brooklyn College. And that is something to really give you kudos for.
Well,
I mean,
thank
that's
you.
Great. Just great. And it's a pleasure to be here.
It's a pleasure to be here. Thank you.
You became the president in 2009. And I know that you came from California State University in Long Beach, which has only 38,000 students. Now you're here at Brooklyn College, and we have approximately 17,000 students. Any similarities in the student population, differences and similarities in these two colleges?
Well, it's a very good question, Paula. Yes, there are quite a few similarities and quite a few differences. The similarities are that it was also and is a very diverse campus in Long Beach, and we also have a very diverse campus here. The diversities are a little bit different in as much as Long Beach, of course, as you know, is in LA, so more Pacific Rim diversity, if you like. Many more Asian and Hispanic and Latino students. Here we have diversities. They tend to be more Caribbean driven as well as immigrant driven from all of the immigrants that come to Brooklyn from all parts of the world, really. That was one of the things that attracted me to Brooklyn College was, in fact, the diversity. I feel very fortunate and honored to be able to work on behalf of such a wonderfully diverse and dedicated group of students. And I can say that the students here at Brooklyn College are every bit as motivated and dedicated as the students at Cal State Long Beach, so in that sense as well. And I think that the faculty and the staff take great pride in working on behalf of students, many of whom are first generation, many of whom are on Pell Grants or on state grants, economically disadvantaged by many standards. And we know every day when we come to work and work on their behalf that we are giving the future leaders of our country an option, a chance to be successful here and to really have many doors open for them with the education that they receive here. So it's a good feeling. Of course, I think Cal State Long Beach is now 34,000 and not 38 because of the budget cuts and the fact that they've had to turn away hundreds of tens of thousands of students in the Cal State system, which is very regrettable. And fortunately, we have not had to do that in CUNY, and I'm very happy that we have not
That's
had
great.
To do that.
That's
some of the differences also are related to the disciplines and the variety of professional programs at Cal State Long Beach. For example, we had nursing. We don't have nursing here. We had, I believe, 9 colleges reported to me. And here, of course, I came and there was only one school of education, and everything else reported to the provost. We had over 30 departments and with a wide variety of disciplines. So the provost and I began to discuss with the faculty the need for creating more schools so that there could be some visible indications of our strengths institutionally, the kinds of programs that we offer, so that we could also have a stronger fundraising team when we talk about the strengths and the opportunities and the potential for academic excellence at Brooklyn College. And so we have created, just in the last year, that's effective this past fall, 4 new schools with 4 new deans.
Fabulous.
So
can
we
you
now
tell us something about
I
it?
Can. We have a School of Humanities and Social Sciences run by Dean Kimberly Phillips, who came to us from William & Mary, very experienced historian and someone who's done a lot of work in American studies, so used to working across disciplines, which is really great for humanities and social sciences. A new School of Natural and Behavioral Sciences, and the new dean is Cleanne Vissaris, who comes to us from University of Texas at San Antonio. He was the chair of computer science there. Lots of ideas, lots of energy. We're very excited about the leadership he's providing. A new School of Business with a new dean of business who came to us from California State University, Chico, who was the dean of business there. Very delighted to be back on the East Coast. And someone who, Dean Hopkins, Willie Hopkins, who is very well schooled in accreditation issues. So we are hoping that our new School of Business will within 3 or 4 years become an accredited school of business, which will be a real asset for our students when they graduate. 25% of our undergraduate majors are in business-related disciplines, so it's a large cohort. That's also true for the sciences, by the way. 25% of our undergraduates are also in the sciences. And then there's a new school, also a visual media performing arts, and the new dean is Maria Canelli, who just happens to be an alum of Brooklyn College, but then who left, went to Columbia for her PhD, and was at FIT as a dean for a while, and then became the executive director of the American Museum of Folk Art in New York. And now she's here, and so she's a New Yorker, a Brooklynite and a New Yorker by training and also by attachment. And it's wonderful to have her back.
That's exciting.
It is. It's very exciting.
It seemed to me that you reached far and wide across the nation.
We did.
But you did get one local person.
We did. We got the best in every pool. Yes, we did. It was a strong national search and a lot of talent, and we're very pleased. And what's lovely to see is that they are, as we call them, the inaugural deans. They're starting deans. So they all have real excitement about beginning from scratch and working together. And then, of course, we do have Dean Shanley, and who's been a dean of the School of Education for 12 years.
Oh, I know her. She's wonderful.
Yes. So it's a terrific team. The provost is thrilled. And the faculty seem to be working very well. There's a lot of changes in a short amount of time for the faculty, but I think they were very impressed with the selection that was made. They had a lot of input in the search committees and in the process, and I think we have a strong and superlative team of leaders.
Are there any funding issues when you're talking about 4 new programs? Was that a challenge?
Well, yes, it was a challenge, and so what we did, we took some lines that were already vacant, that were administrative lines, and we rearranged them. And in fact, we created no new lines this way. We also took staff from certain areas where it appeared that we had perhaps, I won't say overfunding, but sufficient and then some funding, and we moved them into the dean's offices. So these are very lean operations. We were fortunate to receive funding from our own Brooklyn College Foundation, which is our philanthropic arm of the campus, and they provided us with significant funds for renovation of offices for the deans. So without that, it would have been more expensive than it was. We put in a modest amount of college resources, but we had very strong support from our foundation because, of course, they recognize what fundraising leaders these people are going to be, and they already are doing so, so we're thrilled.
Well, I think it's remarkable that you have 4 new programs in place. And are there any other new initiatives that you want to discuss? Is there anything in the film or
yes,
cinema program?
We do. We have a very strong department of film, but to this point we've only had undergraduate programs in film. And we are now building 7 different degree programs, graduate programs in cinema, some of which will be interdisciplinary with business, and certainly working with theater on the design sets side of things, and even with music, because there will be some music composition for film components to this. And the exciting thing is that this will be the only graduate cinema school in the United States to be situated on a working film lot at Steiner Studios. And in addition to that uniqueness, we will also be one of the most affordable, if not the most affordable, film schools in the country. Certainly much more affordable than NYU or Columbia, which are the 2 film schools, graduate film schools in New York City. And of course, USC has a very well-known cinema school, but it also is very expensive as private. UCLA, of course, would be, I suppose, the West Coast equivalent, although their tuition has been going up with the UC budget cuts significantly in the last several years. So we will be probably one of the most affordable in the nation. Certainly, I am sure, one of the most, if not the most, diverse. So once again, we will have workforce impact in very significant ways, because the focus of these graduate film programs will be on production and post-production, the real, the making of the films, not so much the writing of the films, and not so much the producing of the films, but the actual individuals, hundreds of them, in any given film, who are making the movie and who are putting it together after it's been run. So I think that it's a wonderful opportunity. Doug Steiner is a fabulous innovator, and Steiner Studios is a very exciting enterprise for Brooklyn and for New York City, and we're just very proud to be a part of their future.
I think that's so exciting because I had just recently learned that the film industry in New York City is only second to the one in Hollywood, California.
That's correct.
It employs so many people and generates so much money for the economy of New York City.
That's
so
absolutely
to me,
right.
Listening to this is such an exciting thing. The only thing I wanted to ask you is that the unions are very strong, and it's hard to get into the union, so to get employment, and that's what we're looking for so many young people.
That's exactly right.
And so what can we do about that?
Well, actually, that's an interesting question. It's an important question, and while I'm not an expert in this particular area, it is an issue that we have already been exploring, and the film professors have been exploring as an option in our cinema school, that we begin to create a series of very important internships for our graduate students in the industry so that they get a toehold and that they can then presumably fast track those connections. But you're absolutely right, there is time that needs to be served, and getting into the unions is a challenge, but it shouldn't be an impossible obstacle. So we're going to try to give them every way possible, not just the training, but also the internships that will provide the connections that they want.
That sounds absolutely perfect. Well, maybe we can come visit some of those students once they're in place at the Steiner Studios. We'd love
it
to visit with them.
It would be a pleasure to have you there.
And do an interview with
yes,
some of those.
Yes, that would be great.
What are some of the challenges that you have faced since you've been here? It's really only been about 2 years.
Two and a half years. Well, I think for any new president coming from the outside, and for a provost for that matter, some of the most immediate challenges are always, what is my leadership team? Who are the members of my leadership team? And how, you know, what is missing and what is strong about that leadership team? And so I had to do that sort of assessment on the ground, if you like, and very quickly observe that we really needed to have a vice president for enrollment management, that that was a weak link in the cabinet. So I did a national search, and we hired a new vice president, created that position for enrollment management. It's been very important, and a number of changes have resulted from his arrival and his knowledge, particularly in the digitized area of enrollment management, but also in policies. And so I can see the changes already just in the year plus he's been here that have been very significant and helpful for the institution, helpful for students. It's also been true in the communications and marketing area. I've made a significant hire there as well. So I think those are the two areas where attention needed to be paid pretty quickly. And then, of course, any president these days nationally, I certainly read about it a lot. In public higher education is having to deal with state budgets and legislative support or lack thereof of public institutions. It's not a challenge that I haven't had in other locations, both as a dean in Ohio and as a provost in California. But they're always, you need to learn the territory fairly quickly, and you need to learn what the issues are. And of course, you find yourself every 6 or 12 months dealing with budget reductions and what is the impact for your institution? How can you minimize the damage? The fortunate recent news is that the governor, as you know, in New York and the legislature agreed to have essentially a compact with CUNY and SUNY not to continue with several more years of budget cuts. But the reverse has been that we have also, the Board of Trustees of CUNY and also SUNY, determined that tuition increases would need to be put into effect for 5 years to essentially make up for some of that lost revenue of the last 3 to 4 years. So overseeing an institutional budget as large as Brooklyn College or even larger as Cal State Long Beach, you really need to learn the budget and you need to understand where there is potential for growth in that budget. And if it's not coming from the state, you certainly don't want to see it on the students' backs either. You want to find more growth other ways. So you try to do more fundraising and look for other revenue streams that can, in fact, contribute to the academic enterprise. Some of that is also, I'll be quite honest and say, out-of-state recruitment of students and international recruitment.
Now, so how does that help? Is there more money coming? I understand with international students, they won't be on scholarship. They'll be mostly full pays. So
right. That's also true for out-of-state students in the main.
Okay.
And also, we are, you know, this is an institution, and I would say even across CUNY, that has not spent a lot of time thinking about and planning for summer programming for out-of-state students and for international students, or even January programming. There are a lot of international students who would like to come to an American campus in New York City and perhaps brush up on their English, but also study any number of things, whether it's film, whether it's American studies,
right.
Whether it's cultural institutions in New York City. I mean, this is such a rich area.
Absolutely.
That, and it's an untapped opportunity.
And they come for just the summer or for one semester as of now,
yes.
Here at Brooklyn College?
They can, but we have not been recruiting them per se, but we are starting to. So the whole notion
of... how do you recruit them?
Well...
you send somebody over to Europe?
You don't have to.
Okay.
No, there are many organizations that work for you on the ground. And in fact, we are participating in several organizations that have contacts for a very nominal fee. But also you change your marketing strategies and you find out where you can market. And CUNY is, I have joined a group of CUNY presidents and we are submitting a report to the chancellor in January on opportunities for international student recruitment from CUNY and also more opportunities for study abroad for our own CUNY students.
Right.
How can we enrich the international environment of learning for our students, for our faculty, if faculty take study abroad programs abroad.
Yes.
We want to foster more of that.
And in fact, give them grants, would you give the faculty grants to go abroad and study?
Well, what we need to do, there could be some of that, but again, that's very expensive. What you want to do is develop a financial model that pays for the faculty to do that. And it's very doable. Lots of institutions do this. And we have not been as forward-looking in CUNY on this topic as others. And so we are suggesting a number of ways that are kind of benchmarks for how this is done well elsewhere. And
well, you have a strong background in international education.
I do.
You've received degrees and awards and honors from the Canadian government, the Donner Medal in Canadian Studies, the Governor General International Award for Canadian Studies, and I know your area of expertise is French literature and women in literature, and I just wondered whether you had planned to do anything with the Canadian government at Brooklyn College.
Well, as a matter of fact, not too long ago, it was last year, the mayor's office hosted a breakfast for the mayor of Montreal and brought a number of partners, potential partners together to discuss education, finance, and city development together. So we exchanged a number of ideas about partnering with Montreal, but I also had the good fortune of meeting the president of Concordia University. And so we talked a little bit, happens to also be a female president. I don't know if she's the first woman president, she might be. Of Concordia, which is in Montreal, an urban institution with the diverse kind of student body that we have, and also an Anglophone institution that offers courses as well in French. So kind of mixed bilingual institution. And we did discuss the opportunities there, and I think we will proceed step by step. I know they actually have a pretty strong graduate program in film, for example. So we were talking about the opportunities of maybe exchanging faculty and students. But I also would be delighted to see some cooperation with the Université Laval in Quebec City, or perhaps the Université de Montréal, which is also in Montreal. A number of our faculty have connections to Montreal Francophone institution, so I think that that also could be very interesting for us. And then around the world, of course, I would like to see a number of what I'll call really embedded strong partnerships. We're certainly going to be exploring some in China. We're already having some legwork there. The chair of our film department was in China last month, meeting with some officials at several leading Chinese institutions in Beijing and Shanghai, and I will be going in June to follow up on those, because there are some, again, some opportunities in the arts in particular, but also in business for exchanges and further interaction with international institutions. So I think the future is very exciting in that domain.
Very exciting, and I think I hear the murmurs of an international film festival here.
I think that is very conceivable, yes. I would love to see that happen.
That would be great. You're on a personal level now. Who your own mentors were, and how did you set foot on this wonderful pathway to the presidency of this college?
Well, it was by no means intentional, I have to say that. I have always loved being a teacher and a scholar, and really thought that that would be my life, and never planned to be an administrator, or as some people say, going to the dark side. But
I'm not telling any administrators. You said that. It'll only be on YouTube.
Oh, it's a phrase that everyone uses now and then. You know, I think it's really the result. I've thought about this numerous times. I think it's the result, Paula, of being a very young faculty member when I first went to Bucknell University, younger than I should ever have been. But anyway, and because I was one of the few women on campus, I got invited or encouraged to participate in a lot of committees that I really had no business being on because of my inexperience. Committees like, you know, the University Budget Committee. I have to confess, I had no idea what they were talking about the first two times I went, because I was such a, you know, a naive youngster. But what I did begin to realize is that I liked working with faculty across departments, and that I liked hearing about institutional issues and problems and, you know, ideas and initiatives. And I think that's really where it began. I never imagined that I would be an administrator, but I liked being in the conversation. Yeah, and then, of course, you know, life.
And why French?
Why French? Well, I was a high school exchange student to France, so that's pretty easy. I actually wanted to be, in high school, I put in the yearbook that I wanted to be an international correspondent, because I loved learning about the world, and that was before I went to France. And I loved writing, and I was very interested in politics and economics.
You ever heard of a school newspaper?
No, never. But you know, when you get plunked in a foreign country, I had nominal French. I'd taken it for 4 years, but I really couldn't speak it very well. In your entire day and evening in a French family, you're speaking French all the time. It's kind of like being an immigrant. And it was a lower class family, it was modest means, all girls school. So talk about cultural differences. I really was in a very different place. And you learn survival skills, you learn strategies, you sit in a physics class, they speak French and you have no idea what they're saying, because you don't even know what it is in English. And you know, you become more humble, you know, about what you know and don't know, and even if you know it, you can't articulate it. I have great sympathy for immigrants, because I understand what they're going through. They understand a lot of things, but that doesn't necessarily mean that when they're first beginning that they can say them.
What a sensitive thing to say.
You live through that, and you think again about how you acquire language. Of course, when you're older, how you acquire is very different than when you're a child. But so that changed my life. There's no doubt about that. It didn't help me understand that I was ever going to become an administrator, but it did help me understand that I was interested in all things. Well, I was interested internationally in everything, but I was also interested in all things French. And first France, but then I began to discover Quebec. And I actually taught some courses on West Africa. I've traveled to North Africa several times with my husband. It's sort of through that language you can enter many parts of the world and learn new things that if English is your only key, you will never learn. So I only wish I could speak Japanese and Chinese, and that my Spanish weren't so bad. My Spanish was pretty bad.
Well, I just learned something new. I used to say Quebec.
Yes. Quebec. It's Quebec, yes.
Quebec, so that's...
Because there's an accent. But if you're an Anglophone in Canada, you could say Quebec. Yeah.
Would you want, because of your own rich experiences that opened the door for you, to have students have this kind of an international experience?
Absolutely.
When they're in high school or certainly here in college?
Absolutely. And in fact, that's one of the things I did last year, talking about meager resources and still doing new things. I moved a line out of the president's office and gave it to the provost so that we could open a new Office of International Education and Global Engagement.
So that's new.
That's new. It started this fall, and we started this summer. And we really didn't have a full-time person working on study abroad. And our students, you know, was a part-time person who was doing the best he could, but he had many, many other things to do. So now, and she has a staff person to help her. And we are very keen on raising more funds to support student scholarships so that they can travel abroad. Whether it's in January or in the summer or for a full semester or a year, most of our students cannot really afford the time away for a whole year. First of all, many of them are working one or two jobs. So a year abroad is a difficult challenge for our students and for most CUNY students. But a semester is possible if they really save and get some help, and certainly
summer.
A summer is doable if they have a lot of financial backing. Some of our faculty take students in January for 3 weeks. In fact, we have a trip to China twice a year that fills with 35 Brooklyn College students and 35 students from elsewhere.
Is that just like a 10-day or a week trip?
No, actually it's 3 weeks.
Okay.
It's quite substantial, and they go to several cities. So, you know, you are going to become fluent in Chinese in 3 weeks, but your eyes are going to be open to a whole other part of the world, and you probably will want to go back.
Yes.
And I think that's what, you know, learning, studying, travel opportunities do. They give you the taste for knowing that there's so much more to learn, and the excitement of how different you begin to view just about everything.
Yes, and what you're really fostering is the culture of a world citizen.
Yes, and global literacy, which is what I really believe in. You know, what we should be doing in universities is making sure that our students, you know, we talk about writing literacy and we talk about mathematical literacy, and those are very, very important, and financial literacy, and so is global awareness, global literacy, because our young people today, they are going to have a choice. World issues, world economies, world workforce, global workforce, that is the world they are entering into. And we want them to be as prepared as possible, not only to be in it, but to contribute to it and to lead it.
Yes, what's the most popular major here?
You know, the most popular major is business, finance and business management. And the second most popular is psychology, which has been one of the most popular majors in the United States for at least 30 years.
Yes, absolutely. That was
so it still is, right? We have a marvelous psychology department. And then, of course, I would say one of the majors that is the most rapidly growing, not the biggest yet, but only because it's had to catch up, is the health sciences. That is, and that is a national trend as well. There are so
Absolutely.
Many career opportunities
yes,
there.
Yes.
So we're very proud of our new Master's in Public Health that is a master's with Hunter College and Lehman, and it is a three schools that have come together to provide outstanding graduate programming. For CUNY.
Now Hunter has a new building.
Well, yes, and that's
where
the Masters of Public Health is held.
Okay, so
that's
they're
right.
traveling up to
They
to
are.
Manhattan
they are. But they're graduate students.
Oh, sure. Okay.
Yes.
Listen, if they can go to China, they can go to Manhattan.
They can go to Manhattan.
Okay.
That's exactly right.
And
exactly right.
I just wanted to make mention of the program that you've had in place for a long time now with the Downstate Medical Center.
Yes.
That students are accepted. What am I, can you just elaborate a little
yes,
bit about that wonderful program?
It is a wonderful program, and it has been in existence for quite a few decades. In fact, we have alumni come back and mentor the young students who are here, and they're wonderful. The BAMD program, we accept approximately a dozen students every fall as freshmen into the BAMD program, and they have to, it's a very competitive program. A lot of students don't get in. They need to be pre-med, obviously. They can major in any number of things, but they have to declare themselves as pre-med, and their grade point average needs to stay high while they're here at Brooklyn College, and when they get in, they are promised entry into SUNY Downstate if they hold up their academic...
What do they have to have to hold?
I believe it's, you know, I don't quote me, I believe it's a 3.5, but I'm not sure. It's somewhere between a 3.2 and a 3.5. These are very strong students, and they take tough curricula. Sometimes they're double majors in amazing things. Many of them actually are majors in either chemistry or biology and the arts. I've seen theater, you know, double majors. I've seen music double majors. I mean, they're very accomplished young men and women. And their opportunity for med school is right there with a target in front of them, as long as they maintain their averages. And of course, they have a nice scholarship. It doesn't pay full tuition, but it's pretty significant tuition coverage. So
anybody that knows how difficult it is to get into medical school in the United States can appreciate the value
that's right.
of this kind of a program, because they're automatically in medical
that's right.
school as long as they just keep up their GPA.
That's right.
I think it's a fabulous program.
It is. And we do attract a lot of other students who are going to be pre-med, and they may be going somewhere else. So we are getting our seniors, pre-med seniors, into some very prestigious medical schools, as well as
right.
the prestigious university.
Now, when you mentioned health sciences a short
yes.
while ago, that is a field that is burgeoning, and
that's Absolutely.
Where it's predicted that there'll be more jobs in any other sector.
Yes.
When you say health sciences, I'm assuming you mean x-ray technicians and dental technicians, the technicians as well as...
Well, we don't do that here, actually, because we don't have those professional schools here.
So what are you referring to?
You know, health, well, in the health sciences, nutrition, we're very strong in nutrition, so I guess that's getting into your dietitian area.
Right.
We're also, you know, I don't know the curriculum that well, but certainly in the administration side of the health professions,
okay.
there are many positions there. So. And we're actually exploring some relationships with the pharmaceuticals to have some internships there as well, because there's a great need for individuals going
yes.
who are well-trained in the science arena, but not necessarily practicing science, but being managerial. The digitization of health records,
yes.
so that's certainly an area where our faculty and the health sciences can be working more closely with our computer science faculty, and that's actually, we are in significant conversations with Maimonides here in Brooklyn, which is the largest hospital
yes.
in Brooklyn, Pam Breyer is a terrific CEO of Maimonides, and we are talking about collaborating on the research end, because they have some specific needs, but also on the digitization end, with our graduate students helping and assisting her staff. So it's, I think the partnerships in the health professions in Brooklyn as well as New York City are, the potential is huge, and we need to become more connected to that.
Those are exciting new directions.
Yeah, I think they are.
Next to my last question.
Yes.
How do you keep in touch with students on campus?
Well, we have lots of ways.
Do they have access to you sometimes?
Yes, but I will say this, it's not an open door policy. I mean, there's just too much going on. We have a very strong vice president for student affairs, and in her office, it is pretty much open door to find someone to talk to if there is a crisis, for example, if there's real need. I do have an email, BC president, and I do get a fair amount of email,
okay.
which I review periodically, and make sure that I usually can't answer their questions, but I can route them so
yes.
that they do, and every
yes.
now and then I will answer if I know the right answer, but I don't want to mislead them, so I will make sure that I tell them that I'm routing their question to the right person and identify who that is. We have over 168 student clubs, so there's an enormous amount of activity on campus. Our policy council, that's its name, is actually a tripartite body, which I chair. It meets several times a semester. three times a semester, I believe. And that is composed of one-third students, one-third faculty, and one-third administrators. So we have a lot of substantive conversations there with the students. They tend to be student government leaders, but not exclusively. And of course, we have two student newspapers, and they like to meet with me and ask me questions and get my take on things.
That's great, and I'm taking them home with you to read.
Oh, very, very good. And of course, you know, I mean, when I can, when we're at events, or if I'm just walking across the quad, you know, or I'm at a basketball game, we'll chat. So that it happens in informal ways,
right,
as well as formal
right,
ways.
Yeah. And now we're up to my last question.
Okay.
And can you share with us who some of your own personal mentors were?
Yes, I can. The first person who always comes to mind, besides my father, who was a remarkable man, a pharmacist, very self-made, came from nothing. But I think my first serious mentor was the dean at Bowling Green State, Andrew Carrick. And one day he said to me, I was directing women's studies, I believe, and he said, you should be a dean. And I looked at him, I think in horror. I'm not sure why. I know, I just remember I said, why would I want to do that? And he said, well, because you're good at administrating, which I wasn't quite sure. I mean, I had an idea of what he meant, but, you know, really, not quite sure. We had several conversations about that later. I did become an associate dean at Bowling Green State as a result of his encouragement. Also, the graduate dean invited me to apply for a position in the graduate school. So he was a very important mentor. I would say that Joanne Bora, who hired me, she was provost at the time at Old Dominion, and she hired me and hired a number of deans. She was inspirational. She had been at Fairleigh Dickinson as a dean before she went to Old Dominion. She's been the president of Ball State now for at least 5-6 years, I'm losing track. She was a really impressive leader, and I learned a lot from her, and I have huge respect for what she taught me. Well, let's see, when I went to, I left to become Dean of Arts and Sciences at the University of Cincinnati, and I would say that my mentor there, in terms of watching and learning, was, who came after me, was Nancy Zimfer, who's now the Chancellor of SUNY.
Sure.
She became president while I was there, and again, I have enormous respect for what she was able to accomplish. She walked into a very challenging situation, budgetarily speaking. And I also believe that this will probably make him smile if he ever hears this, that F. King Alexander, who's president of Cal State Long Beach, was a very important mentor for me as well, despite the fact that career-wise, I was quite a bit older than him as the provost. But he had a lot to teach me about, and to teach the campus, about issues of public funding for public higher education. He is a master in that area. He does consult and give testimony on the Hill frequently. He's a good friend, I gather, of Arne Duncan's, current Secretary of Education. And we really learned a lot from him, I say we the cabinet, because he was always giving us things to read and websites to go to, and garnered a real education, higher education public funding, which I never would have had he not been the
president. And you're probably using that knowledge now.
I am, absolutely.
Terrific.
And I think it was a very important learning opportunity for me. So I would say, I think that's always true everywhere along the way. You can find helpful people who will give of their time and help you learn new things if you're looking for it. And
right.
I've always tried also to be a mentor to others who are seeking the same thing. Because, after all, people who work in universities are people who like to learn. Otherwise, we wouldn't be there.
Exactly.
We're learners all
exactly.
the time.
Exactly.
And we need to keep learning, and there are always new things to learn.
Well, this has been wonderful. Thank you so much for sharing time with us.
Thank you fabulous, very much.
Fabulous, fabulous time.
Enjoy
and
it.
I hope maybe you can be my mentor one day.
Well, we can exchange.
Thank you.
We can exchange tips on that. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much.